Have you ever noticed that almost all watches that show up in ads have the same time setting? Well, let us take you on a short journey. In the 1920s and 1930s, the default time setting in watch advertisements was 20 past 8. This time setting had the aesthetic advantage of being symmetrical and not overshadowing the logo of the manufacturer. However, since the 1950s, the default time setting has changed. Watches have commonly been set at 10 past 10 in a state of 20 past 8. Assuming that this new setting will positively affect customers because it resembles a smiling face while still preserving the same aesthetics as 20 past 8. But this was just an assumption, and here comes the role of the study we are discussing today. The aim of the study was to provide the first empirical evidence that using watches with a time setting resembling a smiling face, like 10 past 10, would positively affect consumers. And to achieve this aim, two experiments had to be conducted. The first one included 46 participants, 20 men and 26 women. The participants didn't know the hypothesis of the study nor its aim. Every participant was shown consecutively the pictures of 20 different watches. Each watch was present in three photographs. In one photo, the watch was seen at 10 past 10, which was supposed to resemble a smiling face. In the second one, it was seen at 20 past 8, which was supposed to look like a sad face. And in the third one, it was set at 11:30 as a neutral time setting. The participants were shown the photographs in a random order on a computer monitor. The researchers measured the emotional response to each of the three different time settings using the pleasure scale of self-assessment mannequin of Bradley and Lang, SAM for short. This pleasure scale consists of 5 pictograms, ranging from a smiling happy figure to a frowning unhappy one. After seeing each picture, the participants had to rate their pleasure by choosing one of the pictograms in the scale. Then, they were asked to rate their intention to buy the watch on a scale ranging from minus 10 on no account to plus 10 on all accounts. The results were a little bit complex. Generally, 10 past 10 setting, as expected, caused higher pleasure and stronger intention to buy than the two other settings. But on the other hand, 20 past 8 setting, which was supposed to negatively affect the people, didn't show a significant negative effect on the participants when compared to 11:30. Actually, it didn't affect the participants neither negatively nor positively. This experiment also revealed that, in comparison to men, women had much stronger pleasure after seeing the 10 past 10 setting. Now, it's time for the second experiment. This one was to test if people would perceive a resemblance between any of the three time settings in a smiling face or a sad face. 11 men and 12 women, a total of 23 individuals, took place in the experiment. This time, all the results were just as expected. 10 past 10 setting was seen to highly resemble a smiling face, while 20 past 8 was perceived to look like a sad face. To conclude, the results of both experiments were really intriguing. They were compatible with some recent studies that found a relation between behavior and subconscious exposure to masked facial expressions. In addition, the results were also in line with other studies that showed that women are superior to men in perceiving and interacting with facial expressions of emotions. On the other hand, No one can deny that there are other factors that determine the intention of a customer to buy a watch, like preference to a specific watch brand and style, or the presence of other encouraging shapes and symbols in the advertisements. Thumbs up, for example. Some might also argue that pleasure scales other than SAM could have been used. As a result, the authors suggested a bunch of future experiments that would tackle these limitations and provide further evidences and more refined results. The authors also made us wonder whether using what we can call neuromarketing is ethical or not. At the end, we think that this paper provided a small, but still a very beneficial contribution to the field of psychology. And despite being a short study, it managed to hit many right boxes, not only in psychology, but also in marketing. And this shows us an example of how the scientific research is a real multidisciplinary process.